Hi, I'm Brandon. I'm an alcoholic.
First off, I feel really rude.
All right, it's video making time. Got my coffee. It is 11/11/2022. I'm in my heart is in a good place. And my soul is in good spirits. And this, no joke, I have not cleaned this. I have not washed formerly this coffee cup once. Since this whole video series started. I'm a gross individual. I really, truly am. Alright, I'm gonna actually write in a note. Wash this coffee cup. Okay, that's enough. That's enough of that. So, the question that I imagine is on everybody's mind is, what have I been doing and how have I been doing? Very good. I'm sure you've seen the title at this point. I am in the program, technically. I go every night. It has been a very good thing in my life. I'm a big advocate of it, and I'm going to talk all about it in this video. I'm going to keep peeking at my notes here. So let's just start this off. I don't know. I told myself I'm going to take a week off. Why? Well, one, this is what I'm going to do from here on out. I'm only going to make a video if I'm in the mood and want to. Trying to put one out when you're not in the mood, it's not good. Because as soon as you start losing retention time and all that, your channel starts sinking. And I'm not going to put out crap just because I feel like there's an obligation. But every day for me for the past 2 weeks has started the same way. Awkwardly texting I love you too to men. To a bunch of men texting me saying I love you. We can recover. And I love you too. Then I silence my phone and I don't look at it for the rest of the day until I go to the meeting. But it's a good thing. It's a very good thing. Brethrenship, community. Feeling like people have your back. That's a good feeling. No joke, I get texts every day from people asking how I'm doing. I do have a sponsor who I don't call every day. I think you're supposed to do that. But one of the things I said in the video that I'm sure I've shown at this point is I don't like bugging people. I don't even like talking on the phone anymore. I much prefer text. As soon as somebody calls me, I just get stressed out and I silence my phone and I usually just let it sit. And then, but to counteract that, I text every day. Oh, I'm doing good. And let me tell you, I'm starting to have like these 100% sober days bleeding together and I'm sleeping for 8 hours in my dreams. Are only mildly upsetting. For the longest time. Oh God, the dreams. They just sucked. And I'd wake up with a dry mouth. And oh man, it was horrible. Now I'm really, my brain is starting to like regulate itself. And let me tell you. I'm shaking the camera. The first benefit you get if you start going to meetings every night. Is it dampens your relapse urges by like 70%. When you're on your own, left to your own devices, thinking I'm going to do this my way, I'm going to fix it my way, and I'll get into this. We'll talk about surrender. But when you I've tried doing that 1,000 times. It doesn't work. I can't do it on my own. And maybe I'm like a special, unique, like bad addict, but seriously, I believe it. Step one, admit you're an addict and surrender. You kind of have to do that when you're someone like me. Because I've tried. I've tried every which way. I've repeat tried a bunch of ways. Like, I always had these weird methods where I'm like, okay, I'll get 7 days sober, then I'll go back to work, and then blah. It never works, okay? So where am I? Okay, so if you're left alone to your own devices, trying to do it on your own, every day for a long time, you're going to have, like, these relapse thoughts. And I still have them, like, 5 times a day. But when you're going to meetings every night, they're, like, silenced. You're, like, silencing the voices in your head. Like, for instance, yesterday, the night before yesterday, I went to a meeting. And yesterday, I had to go do some errands. And I kept passing liquor stores. I'm not even really an alcoholic. But I was like, yeah, maybe I'll get, like, some shots or... And then I just said, no, don't do that. I'm not going to do that. Now, had I been left to my own devices, perhaps I would have done that. But I didn't. So it dampens that horrible, just repetitive, you know, my mind, when left to its own devices, is a bad neighborhood. So that's what I've been doing for 2 weeks, every night, well, just about every night. Go to a meeting, I usually see the same 3 fellas there who kind of accepted me into their crowd, very good people, text me every day. As I get through each day, one day at a time, big saying in the groups, one day at a time. And I want to talk a little bit about something I realized, like, yesterday. So when you first join the program, which, by the way, it might not be for you. I think it's for me. So far, I've had good results. There's this whole thing of, like, surrender and admit you're an addict. Well, here's the thing. Is I've known I've been an addict for since I was 16. I knew. I'm like, this is not normal behavior. Like, I'm starting to associate anxiety relief with hitting people up and driving up and getting a swab of pills and smoking and drinking, all that stuff. I've known the whole time. I've never been in denial of that, which I think makes it worse. Because you hear these stories where these people are drinking for like 20 years. And then they finally join the program and they admit, they finally realize they're an addict and they were in denial about it. I've known the whole time. I knew when I was 16, I was like, yeah, this is the wrong path I'm going down. So I think surrender, what it means is like, you know what? This is out of my hands now. I'm either going to hand it over to God, to whom I see it or whatever. Some people think the program is like white Christian Jesus. No, it's not. There's like a whole bunch. There's Jehovah Witnesses people there, I see. But you kind of, I have tried so many which ways. And I realize it's sort of this narcissistic, like, I can fix myself if I make a plan. And a big thing I used to say is, oh, well, if you run every day and keep positive, you'll stay. So that never worked. You know, I preached that a lot at the beginning of this series. Really never worked for me in the long term. And, like, I used to do this method that this will show how, like, desperate I've been in my life, where I would get my script of gabs, okay? And I'm like, dude, I'm taking these way too much. I don't know how to stop. Like, I couldn't not do it for 3 days at a time and then take a break. 3 days at a time, take a break. So one time I devised this ultimate plan, thinking I can fix everything myself, where I took half of the capsules and I filled them with flour. So there were like 45 flour ones filled with flour capsules and then 45 regular. I put them in a bucket. This is so stupid. And I shook them up. And then in the morning, I would grab a few and swallow them. And I'd be like, maybe if it's, it was almost like taking my addiction and turning it into a game of Yahtzee. where every morning I'd be like, I don't know if I'm technically taking them. Like that, I tried stuff like that. Never worked. It doesn't work. And if you're like me and you just have failed so many times, you eventually have to be like, all right, whatever this surrender shit is, I'm going to do it. One day at a time, I'm just going to go to meetings. I'm just not, one day at a freaking time. And now look at me. Do I look healthier? I think so. I shaved before this video. And I shaved for a while. I shaved for like 25 minutes. I'm like, yeah, I'm getting all those little hard parts like up here. And then after I shaved, because I want to look healthy for the camera, I left a whole patch, of not shaven face. I forgot what I'm talking about. This is why I take notes, so I don't rant for too long. Let me refer to my notes. So, yeah, I hope I'm being fluent enough in this video. So that's been my life for 2 weeks. I don't know if I showed the video yet already, but I do have the video. I basically just went to the closest one near my house 2 weeks ago. And I sort of, like, I waited for the first guy to finish talking. And I was like, hi, I'm Brandon, I'm an addict, alcoholic, I'm a... And I was like, I basically just begged. I was like, somebody please just help. Please help me. I've tried this millions of times. I fail every time. And, you people seem to know the answer. So, that's been a big thing for me, is shut up, shut the fuck up, and just listen. And after I did that, I met up with a few dudes who have been buds in my life as of late. They gave me their number, and I officially got a sponsor. So the next night, I met him at a Starbucks. And he took me to another one, and he said, just come with me every night to whatever meeting I'm going to. And here's the thing, is I see the same people every couple days, and there's a lot of people. Like, some of them have like 80 people. I don't remember it being this many people. Maybe it's because like the fentanyl stuff is going wild lately. But yeah, you see the same people every day. They hug you. You have to awkwardly tell them you love them too. And here's the thing. Every single night, I don't want to go. I'm like, ugh. Because I've become more hermit-like, especially the past 3 months. And I don't like being around people. I'll slowly get back to that, and I think I'm doing that. But when you become hermit-like, like I have, you kind of, being around a bunch of people is super stressful, you know? You're so used to looking at screens all day and being by yourself and not sleeping. So when I pull in, I'm like cursing under my breath. I'm like, I don't want to be here. But my mind is like, dude, just go. Just push it. Just do it. Just face your fear. Do it. Every single night, I do it. I go, shake some hands, sit, listen, very inspirational stuff. And then afterwards, I'm like energized by the social pressure and the talking and the listening and being around a bunch. So you literally, it's almost like behavioralist therapy where you're like, I don't want to do this, but I'm going to make myself do it. And then all the, like I've said before, when you go to a meeting, there's a spirit in the meeting. And it's very contagious. It's very optimistic. It's very positive. And you're like, when you leave, you're like, now I know why I do this. Now I know. And then there's a whole path ahead of you. Like, for instance, I don't know what working the steps even means yet. And I told that to the sponsor guy I have. And he said, don't worry about that right now. Just show up every night. Just don't quit thinking about all the stressful stuff and just show up. So that's what I've been doing. I don't want to make this video too long. What else do I have to talk about? So it's been mostly good, but now I'm going to talk about the struggles. But these are personal things that I deal with, personal mental problems I have. There are two main things that have been sort of an obstacle I've had to overcome. One, nervous laughter has always been a very, like, serious problem in my life. You know, when you're like, say, imagine you're at a meeting and you're just sitting around and it's really quiet and somebody starts crying and you feel their pain, like you feel it and you're not laughing at them. But it becomes so uncomfortable that you start thinking of like, oh man, this is bad. I have this thing where if it becomes too tense, I'll like have to bury my face into my hands, or I just have to leave the room because I'm like, what if I start laughing? And then I start thinking, if I start laughing, then I won't be able to stop. And then trying to resist not laughing. And I'm not laughing at anybody or trying to be rude. But I seriously, I have this problem. Like, one time, my brother-in-law would constantly, I don't know how, he would slam his hand and break his fingers, shutting his own car door. And one time we had to all go to, like, a family reunion, and he shut, I don't know how he kept doing this. He kept breaking his hand, but I'm in the car, and he went to shut my door, and he broke his finger. Like, it got stuck in the door. And he was, like, in a lot of pain. And I laughed for 45 minutes all the way to the family reunion. Oh, no. Why did I do that? Oh, God. Okay. That's the worst. Don't. This is another problem. Side note is thinking about cringy shit you've done in the past. I've been thinking about shit like that all day. That's a big one. But that's a big problem I have, and I actually had to tell the people that I'm in the thing with. I said, if you ever see me just get up and bolt out of the room, it's because I have, like, this anxiety disorder thing where I'll start laughing, especially if somebody starts crying and it gets really uncomfortable. So that is one struggle I've had. Two, I acquired, I don't think I have this naturally, I have, like, this foot odor disease. It's natural, but in situations like job interviews that are very tense and anxiety is really high, it's like my feet will start smelling, like, and it's like a weird chemical smell, and I'm trying to figure out how it happened. There's two ways it happened. One, when I went to jail for the first time, I was young, wet behind the ears, didn't know what, I was green, I didn't know what the hell I was doing. They gave you, like, a little towel to take showers with, but in jail, or in any public, like, shower thing, you have, people wear flip-flops, because you're not supposed to let your feet touch that disgusting, grimy public shower floor. And I didn't know that. So when I went to jail the first time, I just took my little... Oh, God. Jail, they try to humiliate you as much as they can. For a shower, they give you a towel that's, like, this big. So I got in the shower with no flip-flops. They didn't give me flip-flops. And I remember after I got out of the shower, I'm like, I gotta make it back to my cell. And all I have is this skimpy hand towel that doesn't even, like, fit the circumference of my body. So I just walked across the jail day room vulnerably with a skimpy towel. Don't look. And I remember one of the cellmate guys was like, "Oh, did you just take a shower without flip-flops?" And I was like, "Yeah." He was like, "Oh, you shouldn't have done that." And I'm like panicking. I'm like, "Why?" And he's like, "Oh, people get gangrene and permanent foot diseases." So I'm like, did I acquire this foot odor thing from that? Or two, one time me and my dad did a job for this Indian family, and it was like a painting. We had to paint their garage, and we realized that we underbid the job, so we were going to make like $800, and we realized if we painted like normal painter guys, it was going to take a week. So my dad was like, fuck it. He was like, we're not getting paid enough. I had this machine, and it was like a machine he tied to his back. It was like a paint spraying machine, but it was broken, and it was leaking the paint all over this garage floor. And I remember I was just looking at him, he was spraying paint all over the walls, trying to take a shortcut, essentially. I gotta stop shaking the camera. And I just remember looking, and there was paint all over the floor while he was trying to cut this corner, spraying it all over the wall. But I looked at the can, and it was not paint. It was semi-gloss, which that shit does not come out. If you get that all over your garage floor, good luck. So for the we made the job 2 weeks longer by that, because we had to spend 2 weeks spraying, dumping acid all over the floor and on our hands and knees scrubbing this shit out of the floor. Because he wanted to take a shortcut. And I remember the acid was like all over my feet. And it was burning my feet. And for like a couple weeks, both of our feet had this weird acid smell. So now if I'm ever in a group of people, sitting around with my shoes that I think are clean. I get this like foot smell and I'm like, ugh. And it tends to get worse, especially if I'm like nervous. So I got this powder to like put on my feet. So yeah, that has nothing to do with sobriety. I don't even know why I told that story, to be honest. So I think I covered most of it. I'm going to make this one short. It's probably going to be the only video this week because mainly I got to stop being so grandiose with all this. Like, oh, I'm going to conquer sobriety. So I'm not going to do that. I'm going to shut up. I'm going to listen. I'm going to keep it up. I'm seriously feeling a lot more back to normal. It does get better. And I got pissed off because the one I went to last night, this guy went up and he told a very inspirational story, but he kept saying it gets better, but it doesn't get easier. And I was getting pissed off because he kept saying that. And he kept saying that he kept doing this analogy where he was like, stand up. All right, now you all sit down. And he was like, only 3% of people get sober. I'm so sick of that message. I don't even believe it. I don't even think they counter in like basically, if you go to any rehab, they always say this, and I swear to God, there's like a conspiracy to get people to have this defeatist attitude where they're like, only 3% of people get sober. That's bullshit. They're not taking in the fact that maybe 70% of them do get technically sober, but maybe they drink or maybe they occasionally use. So I'm so sick of that. Oh, it doesn't get easier. It does get easier. It does get easier. And it's getting easier for me. And I have this support system now. So I highly recommend it. That's what I've been doing. And I'm feeling a lot better. Some days are still hard, of course. But I do it. Just do it. You can do it. And do this. Maybe don't do it immediately, but do it eventually. Because whatever it is that this program provides, I believe in it. I believe in it. Hope you guys are doing well. Thanks.